Penguin Audio presents Red, White, and Blood by Christopher Farnsworth, read by Bronson Pinchot. To Marv, who started being my dad long before he married my mom. Thanks. An election is a moral horror, as bad as a battle, except for the blood. George Bernard Shaw. Prologue, June 23, 1975, Ojai, California. Jenny straddled Tom's lap in the back seat, her tongue deep in his mouth. The Eagles wailed on the radio. He lifted his hands under her blouse to her breasts. She ground herself into his crotch and he let out a groan. Tom's erection threatened to tear through the zipper of his pants. They'd been here so many times before. He knew he'd have to stop soon. Tom and Jenny came to the overlook near the creek bridge every night now. They didn't even make a pretense of going to the movies or out for a burger. Just hours of dry humping and kissing before curfew. Then Jenny, as if an alarm clock went off in her head, would pull back and rearrange her clothes, put her bra back on, and tell him to start driving home. Tom thought he'd explode if this kept up much longer, but he forced himself to stay patient. As frustrated as he got, Jenny was the hottest chick he'd ever seen, let alone touched. Unlike most 17-year-old guys, he could be a little patient. Tom wasn't about to blow this chance. She moaned and ground harder. Tom's eyes crossed under his closed lids. She broke away for a moment, both of them gasping for air. "We should stop," he managed to choke out. She reared back from him, her mouth spread into a grin. "Fuck that," she said and laughed. With one swift move, her blouse was off and over her head. "Fuck me," she said to Tom. He didn't have to be told twice. His pants became a ball on the floor of the Buick. She shimmied out of her own tight jeans and underwear and then pulled him on top of her again. God, they were both naked. This was really going to happen. They were really about to do it. Tom hesitated. "What?" Jenny said. "I swear to God, if you tell me you don't have a rubber." Tom tried to look out the window. It was totally steamed over by their breathing. "I thought I heard something." She smiled at him. She thought he was stalling. "You don't have to be nervous. I want to do this, really."
"So do I," he said.
He thought he heard the sound again, like something swishing through the tall grass at the side of the road.
"You didn't hear that?"
She shook her head.
"You're not scared of the Charman, are you?"
They both laughed. The Charman was an old story passed along from senior to freshman at Nordoff High. Supposedly, some guy was caught in a big fire back in the 40s and had gone insane from his hideous burns. Now he lurked in the woods near the bridge and attacked anyone foolish enough to be caught out after dark. It was a joke, nothing more. Sure, bodies had turned up over the years. A couple kids from school went missing, and yes, a few weeks ago there was that story in the paper about the dead hitchhiker by the bridge. But bad stuff happened. Everyone said the same thing. The Charman got them. But they smirked when they said it. Tom looked at her. This was what he'd wanted for so long.
What was he waiting for?
"I'm not scared," he said. She smiled and leaned back a little. He could see everything. Jesus, she was beautiful. All Tom could think was, "Oh, man, oh, man, oh, man, oh, man." Then there was the terrible scraping noise of metal on metal. Tom and Jenny both turned toward the sound in time to see the door of Tom's Buick peeled away like the pop top of a beer can. A huge man stood framed in the weak glow of the dome light. He only stood there a split second, but Tom knew he would never be able to erase the image from his mind. A full-sized axe looked like a toy hatchet in one of his hands. His clothes were ragged leather, sewn together in irregular patches. and the smell. The smell was like a sewer below a slaughterhouse. It hit them like a physical slap. Worst of all was his face. Skin hanging on the skull in long yellowish drips like wax melted and left to cool in place, crisscrossed with blackened scabs that oozed fresh blood. The Charman. He was real. Tom had no time to recover from the shock. The Charman's hand darted into the car, impossibly quick, and yanked Jenny from the back seat. She fell on the ground. Tom could hear her screaming. His own mouth was open and his throat was raw. He realized he'd been screaming the whole time, too. He scuttled back as far as he could into the corner of the seat. The Charman roared with frustration and reared out of the open door. A second later, the blade of the axe bit through the roof of the car directly above Tom's head. It began to move, drawn back through the metal and upholstery like a knife. The Charman was literally slicing the roof open to get to Tom. His eyes darted out the open door. He saw Jenny, frozen with shock. He managed to form a single word. "Run!" he screamed. That broke her from her daze. She got to her feet, tripped, fell, and got up again. Tom heard the tortured metal of the car give way. The roof was suddenly open to the night sky, distant stars completely oblivious to what was going on beneath them. A shadow blotted them out as the hideous shape loomed above him. Tom's eyes darted involuntarily back to Jenny, who barely seemed to be moving at all. She had just made the edge of the road when Tom heard the grunt from above. The Charman had seen her too. If it was possible to read that melted nightmare of a face, Tom saw frustration. The Charman was not about to lose one of his victims. Tom saw the Charman lift the axe and cock it back over his shoulder. He knew what was coming next. He tried to yell, but the blade flew before Tom could draw a breath. It spun end over end in a perfect spiral toward the back of Jenny's head. As if she could sense it coming, Jenny turned and looked. Tom saw tears streaming from her eyes as the axe whirled like a rotor through the dark. Then, out of nowhere, a hand snatched it from midair. For a moment, everything stopped. Tom and Jenny went silent. The Charman stood like a statue. They all looked at the man who had not been there only a second earlier. He didn't seem much older than Tom. He was just a guy in a cheap suit. He certainly didn't seem anywhere near as powerful as the Charman. But he wasn't afraid. Tom could see one unusual thing about him. He wore, under the open throat of his shirt collar, a metal cross that glinted in the moonlight. It was so at odds with the rest of his outfit and his square haircut. The young man looked at the axe, then at the Charman, and finally broke the awful silence. "You dropped this," he said. "By all means, have it back." He hurled the axe. It spun through the air even faster than before, a pinwheeling blur that ruffled Tom's hair. He seemed to hear the impact seconds after it must have happened, a deep, hollow thunk, as if the axe hit wood rather than bone and meat. The Charman stared at the axe lodged deep into the space between his eyes. Then he toppled over. Hands grabbed Tom. He was being hustled from the car by someone else. Another man, not so young, wearing a suit as well. Clearly a plainclothes cop, Tom thought, despite the shaggy sideburns. The guy pulled a gun from a shoulder rig, and that was all the confirmation Tom needed. "Come on, kid, move," the cop said. "We've got to get out of here." Tom realized they were jogging toward the young man and Jenny. The man had given Jenny his coat.
"But wait, what's going on?"
Tom wanted to know what was happening. Why were they running?
"What about my car?"
They reached Jenny. The cop was still hustling them toward the road. A car waited there, exhaust puffing from the tailpipe. The young man gave Tom a look that chilled him as deeply as the sight of the charman. "Answers later," he said. "Move, now."
"Who are you?"
Tom asked.
"Shut up and get in the damn car,"
the cop ordered, and Tom and Jenny complied. They piled into the back seat. The young man stood by the passenger side while the cop got behind the wheel. Just as he put the car into drive, the engine died. The sudden quiet lay over them like a shroud.
"Ah, damn,"
the cop said. He jerked at the shifter and tried to restart the car.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.